here?
No, I'm enjoying this.
Well, I can't watch. Excuse me.
Scrawled in blood. What's it say? See you next Wednesday.
It's only a movie.
It's not funny.
You were scared, weren't you?
I wasn't that scared.
Yeah, you were scared.
Close to midnight, something evil's lurking in the dark. Under the moonlight, you see a sight that almost stops your heart. You try to scream, but dare I take the sound before you make it. And you start to freeze, and so it looks you right between your eyes. You're paralyzed. You hear the door slam and realize there's nowhere left to run. You feel the cold and wonder if you ever see the sun. You close your eyes and hope that this is just imagination. Creeping up behind, you're out of time. They're out to get you. There's demons closing in on every side. They will possess you unless you change that number on your dial. Now is the time for you and I to cuddle close together. Yeah. Terror on the screen, I'll make you see.
Darkness falls across the land. The midnight hour is close at hand. Creatures crawl in search of blood to terrorize y'all's neighborhood. And whosoever shall be found without the soul for getting down must stand and face the hounds of hell and rot inside a corpse's shell. And grisly ghouls from every tomb are closing in to seal your doom. And though you fight to stay alive, your body starts to shiver. For no mere mortal can resist the evil of the thriller.
What's up, everyone? Welcome to the 169th edition of the Sports Reality. My name is Jeremy John, here to bring to you all things sports. That was a great choice of music, Mike. Let's welcome Mike in the building, man. How's everything?
Everything's good, man.
Man, how was the weekend, man?
It was good, man. I'm very disappointed in football right now because 2 weeks in a row it happened. But we get to it later.
Yeah, we will get to that. And we'll get to what Mike is talking about. You see, that was a great teaser. You didn't actually say what you're talking about.
It was a weekend of horrors for the past 2 weekends in NFL scheduling. That's all I can say.
I mean, if you're me, it was great.
Oh, of course. Okay.
And we'll get into why it was a great 2 weeks in the NFL. But we have a lot
over people and shit.
We got a lot to talk about. The World Series going on right now. NBA regular season started. We already won weekend pretty much, and it's probably been probably the best like first week of an NBA season in the recent history. We will get into that. Also, once again, NFL news, college football news, and all the good stuff. Let's start off with today in sports history. Today is October 31st, 2016, aka Halloween.
A lot of spooky stuff goes on.
1950, Earl Lloyd of the Washington Capitals became the first African American to play in an NBA game.
Boo.
Oh, that was corny.
That's right. It was 1968,
the Milwaukee Bucks won their first game. They beat the Detroit Pistons 138-118.
And then they lost their first game.
Oh, I don't.
I mean, they won their first game.
Yeah, and then they lost it. Yes, you're right.
They lost their first.
Then that came sometime either before. It was probably after, because usually the NBA used to always start on Halloween.
Wow. That's
like for a long time, that was a tradition. It just always started on Halloween. Like, that's when the season started. 1995, the NHL's New Jersey Devils announced that they would stay in New Jersey. 1999, Brian White sang the national anthem at the Adelphia Coliseum in Nashville prior to the game between the Tennessee Titans and the St. Louis Rams. Following the game, White gave his second annual Halloween concert at the north end of the stadium. Okay, I don't even know who Brian White is, to be honest. Do you know who that is? I thought what if with me reading more and more, I would have figured something out, but I don't know who Brian White is. Watch, he's like...
You had said Barry White? We probably would have had something there.
Yeah. But maybe he's part of some like popular band that we're just like not thinking about.
Like Hootie and the Blowfish or something?
I don't even know. Is it Darius Rucker? That's the lead singer.
That's the lead singer. Hootie and the Blowfish, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know the rest of the guys.
Exactly. And you know, like in the Foo Fighters, when they, you know, their lead singer came from Nirvana, so possible.
Let me look up who this Brian Wright guy is, and I'm going to laugh if it is somebody who is actually very popular. Brian White, American country music artist.
Move on to the next day.
Oh, bang, bang. You are funny. Move on to the next topic.
I mean, no. Look. I like all the country fans. I apologize if I disrespected y'all, but I'm letting you know there's more hip hop fans and
nah, bro. I don't know, man. Country music is like, it's big, man. They make money.
I mean, it's
man.
Big, but I mean, this is not an episode of Martin, and we're not turning our station into the Hee-Haw station.
I mean, he looks like, I'm looking at his discography. Or discography, how do you pronounce it? Is it disco? Is discography?
Discography.
That's what I'm saying. It can't be discography. There's not two O's there. Discography. I mean, he has tracks from the early 90s, albums from the early 90s. And his last album was 2009. I mean, pretty decent guy. All right, let's 2001 in Miami Beach, Florida, Jose Canseco was involved in a nightclub brawl. Canseco later violated his probation.
He probably was at a country club too.
It was sentenced to 2 years of house arrest and 3 years probation. 2010, for the first time in Major League history, two former presidents attended the same World Series game. George H.W. Bush and George W. Bush both attended game four of the Rangers ballpark in the Rangers ballpark in Arlington, Texas.
Sorry, it won't be a third like ever. That situation will never. Three of those guys.
A third Bush. Yeah, I mean,
because Jed don't look good.
He don't look good. I mean, no.
He can't throw pitches.
Oh, that's what you're talking about. Yeah, actually, George W. is a he has a great. I mean, he played baseball, like legitimate D1 baseball.
But what happened to Jed though? Like,
I mean, Jed was into politics probably from the very beginning. Probably, man.
Oh well.
All right, listen, talk about baseball. World Series going on right now. Game 5 was last night. Let's, I guess, go through what has happened. Oh, so all 5 games happened after we had our last show. So let's just recap, I guess, or give a little.
Well, we got a save, though, in this one, right? It's not. Well, the Cubs are not done, right?
Nah, Cubs are not done. Cubs are not done. Let me go backwards. So, game 1 was last Tuesday, and the Indians with Corey Kluber going up against John Lester for the Cubs just blasted the Indians just blasted the Cubs 6-0 game 1. They got a lot of help even from some unexpected batters by their catcher, and I'm having a blank on the catcher's name, but the catcher had 2 home runs, and we haven't seen. I mean, think about catchers. Are they usually hard hitters, or heavy hitters, or long bombers?
No, they're just like the middle of the order.
I mean, they're usually near the bottom, and they're kind of like.
Or at the end, yeah.
I mean, there's Pudge Rodriguez and like Piazza and like.
Yeah, but they're great hitters, though.
Yeah, yeah, that's the thing. Right. Like Johnny Bench and. I think Johnny Bench played catcher, and
the only time you see a catcher like in the middle of the order or the top of the order, they got to be a great, hitter.
And I'm having a blank
like that.
Yogi Berra.
Yeah,
Those are typically the catchers that you see dominate. But I should probably click the box score and figure out who this catcher is, right, on my computer, right? That's probably what I should do, right?
That possibly, yeah.
That's the right thing to do.
Or if you're on Google, you can just like hit the bottom little arrow and extend before you can see all the rest of it.
Roberto Perez, that's who it was, who hit 2 home runs against the Cubs in game 1. But game 5 was the complete opposite. I mean, game 2, sorry. Ooh. Game 2 was a complete opposite. Cubs win 5-1. Jake Arrieta was going up against Bauer. Arrieta, one of the stud pitchers for the Chicago Cubs. He used to be with the Orioles and did nothing as an Oriole. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I do.
He did nothing as an Oriole. Orioles can't do anything with starting pitchers. I think that's just what it is.
Yeah, I think if you're already a starting or you're like a star already.
Because Ubaldo Jimenez, when he came to the Orioles, everyone's like, oh, my gosh. Like, this guy's so nice. He's
going to help us, and we didn't have a manager.
Now, the Orioles do have great relievers.
Well, we got good managers now.
And a great manager. Starting pitching is not their thing. But Arrieta led the Cubs to a big victory. Cubs win 5-1. Trying to look through these box scores real quick. You had Ben Zobrist with 2 hits and Schwarber with 2 hits. Who, by the way, Schwarber, game 1 or game I think it was game 2 was his first game back for the Cubs since early April. He had torn his ACL and MCL, but they realized, hey, he might be healthy if we make it to the World Series. So he remained on the postseason roster. He was able to play the DH position because all he had to do is then just go to the plate and hit. Because of course, in the American League, there's the DH position. And I'm gonna go on a quick rant, real quick. I think baseball needs to decide what they're doing. I think both leagues, the National and the American League, need to be unified.
We need to stop acting like they're not unified. First of all, that's the first thing we need to stop acting like. Cause they with the pinch hitter, and that makes it seems like it's not unified. But they're together.
I think personally, they just need to go DH all around.
Yeah.
If you want, you complain about, I guess the viewership isn't really good, the ratings aren't good on the national level. Also, the median age for a baseball viewer. Do you know what the median age is, Mike?
So what?
The median age for a baseball viewer.
Actually, I'm going to go to the median age. Let me go NFL. The median age
it's like 20.
Is like 32.
What, for the NFL?
For the NFL. The NBA, it's a little lower. I think it's like 30. Do you know what the median age for baseball is?
That's kind of sad that you got to be in your 30s to watch sports. I guess 49, 50?
55.
Seriously?
So that just 55. So that just shows it's really old people watching it and like middle-aged people really watching it. You know, I never took a stats class, but I know median means in the middle.
Yeah, it does.
And
50 is a little above.
50 is pretty high. The thing about, like I said, basketball, I think it's like 31 or 32. That means children at the age of like 3 and 4 are actually watching basketball and watching it at a, you know, long enough time that they're able to at least know a little something.
We got like high school graduates starting to watch baseball.
Yeah, you know, that's the thing. So I think baseball needs to go to the DH in both leagues and just have it that way.
See, like,
and to be honest, most of these pitchers can't hit regardless.
See, I'm indifferent, though. I like the anomaly of like forcing a pitcher to go out there and hit. See, at the end of the day, I can see the reasoning by having a pinch hitter.
Or a double switch and all of that. You can still do double switches in the American League, I think. I mean, I think you still can, but you still pinch hit. You can still pinch run. You can still switch positions and things like that. But, I mean, most of the time.
But it's like a frivolous, like,
And it's a waste of time.
It's a loophole.
That's why National League games are longer than American League games. Because you got to worry about this. Like, oh, the pitcher. Now we got to. Oh, it's a tough situation. Should I let this bum pitcher go up there and swing 3 times and miss?
And plus the 7.
Or should I then take the pitcher out, put a pinch hitter in for him, and then now this good pitcher, I don't have him on the plate.
And also, I think they should go ahead and.
I mean, on the mound, sorry. I don't have him on the mound to do what he's got to do. Like, just go to the DH.
Yeah, I feel you. And also, 7-inning stretch, I think that needs to be shorter.
Shortened,
yeah.
I mean, I'm cool with that.
I'm just saying, like, I went to a couple
baseball
games.
Is just full of traditions, man.
It's a lot of traditions, that's what makes the game so long to watch on television.
Yes, the game, I think it was game one or game two, it was 4+ hours, and it went 9 innings. Like, it went the regulation time. The game is just way too long. All right, I said a mini rant, and we've been ranting for about 5 minutes probably on this. But, yeah, so Cubs win game two. Going on to game three, Coco Crisp got the only.
That's a great name for a baseball player.
He got the only RBI, got a run batted in. Indians win game one.
Coco Crisp.
Yeah, he's pretty good. Pretty solid veteran. He's been all over the league, and he already has, I think, a championship ring with the Boston Red Sox.
I also think he has a good medal for the best baseball name.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Coco Crisp.
And then game four, the Indians won 7-2. Wasn't even close. Corey Kluber dominated on the mound. And in game five last night, Lester going up against Bauer. Lester pitching for the Cubs, Bauer pitching for the Indians. This was the game. If you are, all the insiders were saying the Cubs, of course, it's not just a must win for them, but they also did say this is a good matchup because Lester is one of their best pitchers. And Bauer is coming off of a injury where he cut his finger on his throwing hand trying to playing with his what do they call those things? I'm having a blank now. Those flying things in the air.
You're talking about drones?
His drone, yes. Yeah, messing with a drone. He cut his finger, had to get stitches a few weeks ago.
See, no one
missed.
Guy-
I think he missed the start. Then against the Blue Jays in the ALCS, he got in the first inning. He had stitches, and the stitches popped, so he was bleeding. Couldn't pitch that game. So this was his game, the next game that he pitched in. And, he's the Bauer going up again. Bauer is almost like the weak link of the pitchers on both teams. So last night everyone said, well, the Cubs have to, like, beat them, and they're going to beat them because they have the mismatch. And it did show. Lester dominated. Also, Aroldis Chapman came in and had a close to a two-plus inning save, and the Cubs win 3-2. I'm going to be honest. I think we both said the Cubs were going to win, correct?
Yeah.
We both did say that. I remember saying I won't be surprised if the Indians win, but I think the Cubs will win. So far, our predictions are
Not wrong yet.
Well, we're losing so far.
We're losing.
With our prediction.
We're losing because the Cubs decide to get behind, and now they're kind of like, we're kind of almost there to tie it up. But they got to tie it up first before we can be kind of like in the 50-50.
So, of course, I'm still going. I mean, I did say Cubs were going to win. I'm still going with that prediction. I'm not the type to – well, let me say this. At this point, I think the Indians will win. But I'm just, you know, for credibility's sake, I'm just saying, hey, I did say the Cubs are going to win, so I may possibly be wrong. Correct, Mike?
Yeah.
We just may possibly be wrong. Look, I just want to put it out there.
Look, I got confidence that a team that's been around before 1908 is going to finally win a championship since 1908. So I have confidence. And I think, like I said again, I think that city needs it. I mean, if they lose, I mean, hey, they got it next year because literally.
Nah, I think.
Honestly, I have been doing that since 1908.
Honestly, so. Man, when my teams are not, I told my friend this last night. When my teams are not involved, I just love chaos. So
you think the team's gonna get broken down like normal championship follow up teams do?
I think the curse continues, man. The Indians are gonna win. This is the year of Cleveland. Indians are going to win, man.
If Cleveland wins this year, that means they won. I mean, football, they didn't do anything.
They're trash. Browns are trash. And we
so
will
sorry.
Get, it still is.
You the, wanted them back.
It still is the year of Cleveland. But I just wanted to say, yeah, you know, I for credibility's sake, I did say that the
Go Cubs.
Cubs were going to win. Now, am I rooting for them? I'm not rooting for either team. I just want good games. Game six is tomorrow in Cleveland. Who you got winning?
Got the Cubs winning.
I gotta
go with the Cubs.
Oh, so it's going seven.
It's going to go seven.
It's going seven.
This is going to look. If the Cubs win this in this type of situation, this is going to be the biggest thing for that city. Like I was saying, I'm rooting for the city because this is a great way to win. If they win tomorrow, and then they win the overall game, they're gonna be like, "Yo, this was a comeback city." Just saying.
I don't know, man. I can't remember who's pitching tomorrow. I don't know if they've made that announcement yet of who's tomorrow's game, Arrieta against Tomlin. Ugh.
Yeah.
I'm going.
You said you gotta go. You gotta stick with your Cubs.
I mean, I'm going with the Cubs now. They're gonna win game. They're gonna win game six. But game seven, I don't know, man. I think at home.
See again, you can't pick the Cubs then.
I'm just saying.
I know.
I'm just saying. I said they were gonna win. Now you know, hindsight is 20/20. I don't think they're gonna win. but yeah, they're at least going to win six games. I mean, win the sixth game of the series. So yeah, I think Cubs win the sixth game. So let's move on to the college football. Let's move on to college football.
We'll talk about the SEC.
Oh, no, the SEC. We are the SEC.
We are Alabama.
Like, oh, my God.
I have to say it like that because that's really the only team left. It's the truth.
I think we spoke about this last week. We did. And I don't want to bring it up again, but why do SEC teams, whenever another SEC team is winning something, SEC.
It's the best conference. No, it's not.
No, you all are trash because you lost to them, that team. Like, don't be riding on the coattails of Alabama. Let's be real. If Alabama's not in that conference, we ain't talking about the SEC. Am I right, Mike?
Yeah, yeah.
We ain't talking about them.
Talking about Alabama.
Yeah. Alabama. True. We ain't talking about the rest of y'all bums out here doing that. And yeah, Florida's good, you know.
Yeah, but they want to be out of that. I'm going to tell you.
Georgia's pretty good. Tennessee's pretty good.
I feel like that conference really is going to break up. Them. I still think that conference is going to break up in the next 5 to 6 years.
Well, the problem is they're going to start going to these, which is going to be terrible, but they're going to have these four super conferences because then, of course, then it'll just be whoever wins the conference automatically goes to the four-team playoff, and that's why I think they have to expand it to more than four teams. Make it probably six or eight. And so you can get rid of – because these power – you can't make it four power conferences, man. That's just super conferences, they're going to call it. And it's just going to be so many teams in one – oh, my goodness, it's going to be so bad. Anyways.
I mean, but it gives you the playoffs, a legitimate situation for playoffs, though.
No, you're just going to have all these teams in – it just sucks. Like, because then you're going to have these teams that just don't even play each other. Like, there may be a year. Let's say you make these four super conferences. And let's say whoever's in – let's say SEC is one of them. You're going to have Alabama maybe on top of the conference. And the number two team in the conference may not even play Alabama that year. Or may not even play them for a couple years. Because obviously you're going to have to put more than – 15 teams in these conferences now. So obviously you're not going to play everyone every year. That's the cool thing about most of the conferences in this country. You're going to play each other every year with the exception of a few of them like the I think the ACC, you don't play everyone every year, but
no,
then
don't.
They rotate.
You can't.
But if you make it larger, it's going to be even harder to play everyone every year. That's my point I'm trying to say. But, yeah, so let me go through these scores real quick. I remembered – did you – I know you didn't watch it, I know. but there was Clemson, Florida State. My goodness. It was a very good game. The very end of it was Florida State had the ball with a chance to, I guess, get into field goal range to tie the game. And they had back-to-back false start penalties, and then they got sacked back-to-back plays. And so it was like they got sacked on the fourth down play. It was like fourth and like a million yards and still got sacked on that play with a three-man rush, by the way. Three-man rushes should not be getting to the quarterback with five offensive linemen.
That happens a lot in college.
It should not.
It shouldn't happen, but it happens a lot more than
and
it
that's
should.
Why Clemson won 37-34. Clemson's number two. I mean, number three in the nation. Number two, Michigan State beat – I mean, number two, Michigan beat Michigan State 32-23. Jabril Peppers. People were saying he is the, next Charles Woodson because he's playing both sides of the ball and he has touchdowns. He already has more touchdowns than Woodson had in Woodson's Heisman Trophy winning season. But Jabril Peppers played on Saturday, defensive back. And that when I say defensive back, he played safety and corner. Played linebacker.
Hold up.
Played running back. Played wide receiver. played quarterback all in one game.
Huh?
Yeah, all those positions. He played at least a few plays, not like one play. He played at least a few plays at all of those positions.
That's more than Iron Man football. That's that. He's playing both sides of the ball in a couple of positions. At each, on each side. That's, wow. I give him his props. But that means that team needs better players.
I mean.
That's basically what that means.
If that's your outlook on it, I guess.
Yeah, think about it. If you got a guy playing four positions on both sides of the field, y'all need to get four better players or three better players to cover this guy, because this guy only needs to be playing one position. He's that good. Give him his props. He's going to be in the first round.
I think, yeah, he'll definitely be a first-round pick, I think. Is he first-round pick caliber? I don't know. I've honestly have seen him play a couple possessions. I have to see more of his games to see if he's really a first-round draft pick. But he has the talent. He's definitely an NFL player. If you can play all those positions at a high level at a great university, yeah, you deserve to be in the
NFL,
in my opinion.
Or the CFL.
Nah, he's better than Tim Tebow and them.
But I mean, I'm just saying, if he goes to the CBL, the CFL, he could play at least, I don't know, like 20 positions a game. I mean,
20 positions.
He could do it. Do it on each. Like he just had to be out there on each possession, defensive and offensive.
Yeah, man, it's he's pretty good. Washington, number four, went into Utah, which is number 17. One of the one of the very good schools in the Pac 12. They went into Utah, won 31-24. You had Louisville beating Virginia 32-25. Ohio State squeaked out a win against Northwestern 24-20. Number 11, Wisconsin beats number 17, Nebraska in overtime 23-17. Texas gives Baylor their first loss. Texas wins 35-34.
They dropped, didn't they? They dropped down five positions.
Who, Baylor?
Yeah.
Yeah, they
off of that one loss.
Yeah, they dropped down pretty far. Texas A&M beats number. I mean, they smashed, but it was a cupcake game. 52-10. They beat New Mexico State. Did Alabama play this week? I think they had a bye because I don't remember them.
Yeah, Alabama didn't play.
They didn't play this week.
We're talking about Alabama. They didn't even play.
The cocktail party between Florida and Georgia. Florida beat Georgia 24-10. Auburn beat Ole Miss 40-29. And Oklahoma smashes.
That moved Florida up three spots, by the way.
Oklahoma smashes Kansas 56-3. And Tennessee gets another loss, unfortunately, to a bum squad. The South Carolina Gamecocks.
They were good. They were actually good at one point.
When they were good?
Yeah.
The Gamecocks, yeah, they were pretty good for a bit.
Spurrier.
Yeah, that's what it was. Spurrier getting there really put them on the map. Hey, Mike, I put some files in there. It's on the show 169. And when you find it, you could just play the NBA highlights. These are the top 10 plays of a already great first week. And you can play him. I'll just talk over the mic. Anthony Davis. The Pelicans have not won a game this season, but Anthony Davis has been putting on shows. Anthony Davis, the first game of the season, in a loss, had 50 points. Then in another loss against the Warriors, had 45 points. Anthony Davis is the first player since 1986 to start off a season with 90-plus points. In the first two games. Do you know who that player was that scored 90-plus points
in the first two game?
Regular season games?
Kareem?
1986. Well, he did play in 86, though. Yeah, Kareem did play 86.
But it's not his first game, though.
The first two games of the regular season.
86?
Yes. Think about who was in the NBA.
I mean, Jordan just got into the NBA.
Yeah, Jordan dropped 90 in his first.
Are you freaking kidding me? Jordan is in his first two games?
No, not of his career, but of the season.
I know. I'm like in his first two games. Like,
yeah, yeah. Like in his third season, 1986 to 87, had 90-plus points in the first two games. Mind you, the Pelicans lost both games. Man, the Pelicans. I don't know what to say about the Pelicans. They are.
They want Chris Paul.
I mean,
they need him anyway.
They need a lot of players on that team. They need definitely a point guard, and they need another scorer that is not Anthony Davis that can give them something. Also, Russell Westbrook on fire. He is pretty much averaging a triple double right now for the Thunder. The Warriors got their first loss at the very first game of the year. Did you watch that game?
No. Hey, try to put that foul in there again.
Oh, my fault. It's still copying.
Do it again because something bad happened.
Mm-hmm. All right, let me go there. But yeah, did you get to watch the Warriors going up against the Spurs? Last Tuesday night.
No.
Man, man. The Warriors, I mean, okay, we knew they were going to have some issues. Like, we knew that. We knew they were going to have some issues on defense because they have a lot of, I guess you could say they have a lot of offensive players, but they have a lot of, you know, offensive power. They have Kevin Durant and Steph Curry. By the way, isn't it kind of weird, like, Steph is kind of like being outshadowed by Kevin Durant?
No.
I think it's weird. Like going when I say
Kevin Durant is a NBA superstar. Now,
well, like, Curry's a superstar too.
He's a superstar
in
a different
type
of. He's a superstar without opening his mouth.
Especially the last 2 years, I feel like Curry was spoken about all day, every day.
Yeah, but he never had to actually say anything.
And now, you know, he is the defending. reigning MVP, and now you have these. I mean, I feel like no one's really talking about Curry. It's like he's one of the other guys on the team now.
But that's good though.
But we knew that they had issues on defense, but we didn't know it was that bad. Kawhi Leonard, another guy who is going off right now at the beginning of the year, he went off for 35 points. And not just 35 points, a commanding 35 points. Uh-huh. Also, the Spurs have a player by the last name of Simmons. I don't even know his first name. He has a 10-day contract to start off the year. 10-day contract. And from the words of the wise Bomani Jones from ESPN, he said he pretty much can't go back. He can't go back to living paycheck to paycheck like he was. Homeboy has like four kids, and he said going overseas was not an option because of his children's situation. So he's like, yo, I got to make the NBA. He's like, these D-League checks, they ain't really cutting it for what I got to do. So he got a 10-day contract with the Spurs, and I think he made the most of it during just the first game. And we will you'll probably see the highlight. But he had a monster dunk. It might end up being number one when I finally show the highlights as soon as it come up. We're having an issue on my end, by the way. But man, oh man, he put on a show coming off the bench. For the for the Spurs. And the Spurs, I mean, they're not – I don't think they're the best team in the West, but the way they play,
they will be playoffs.
I mean, they're going to give the Warriors some fits because the Warriors cannot – I mean, they're having a lot of penetration. A lot of penetration coming through the middle. Like, guys are just – steamrolling through the paint and just scoring at will. There were so many like points in the paint for the Spurs. Also, there were so many offensive rebounds that the Spurs were able to get. And the Warriors, they kind of looked out of sync. Like during the preseason, they were dominating teams. And then you had the regular season comes around, first game of the year, and it looks like they haven't played with each other. Like, it looked like it was practice for an all-star game, and they were kind of, like, trying to figure out what is everyone going to do. And, they didn't really look good. They lost by 29 points at home, first game of the year. Like, not good. They're, of course, going to be the best team in the West. Also, other storylines in the West, Damian Lillard, oh, my goodness. He is doing his thing for the Portland Trail Blazers. Had 37 points the other night in Denver. Had a nice dunk. It might end up being on the top 10 plays. I don't know what's taking this so long, Mike. Mike, maybe you can do this even faster, Mike. Maybe you can go on YouTube and just go to the NBA channel and pull up the plays, because I don't know what's happening on my end right now. It is, like, taking forever to get to you.
Top 10, right?
Huh?
Top 10?
Yeah, the top 10, I guess, plays of the week. It should say October, like, 25th to, like, is that the one?
I'm looking at it now.
Yeah, so when you have that, just play that, man. We could just talk about what else is going on in the NBA. But, also in the NBA, Russell Westbrook was involved with an incident with a fan. There was a fan who stood up in his face, courtside, and gave him the double-fisted middle finger. like this old white man gave him, and you could see what he said. He definitely said "F you" to Russell Westbrook in his face. And the fan was removed from the game.
What did Russell say?
Russell was kind of talking to the ref, like, "Yo, like, what's going on? Y'all allowing this ref to just walk up on me like this?" And it's very interesting because there was a caller on the Stephen A. Smith show on Mad Dog Sports Radio who was saying, "Oh, I'm kind of ashamed of Russell Westbrook for making such a big deal for this fan giving him the middle finger to his face." And Stephen A. Smith said, "So what if Westbrook had did the same thing to that fan? Like, the fan had said something to him and he gave him the middle finger." He said Westbrook
had to pay for it.
He would have been fined, possibly suspended for a game or two, but definitely fined heavily. We saw Kobe Bryant when he hurled out that homophobic slur, how much money he was fined. Like, like a $90,000 fine or something crazy.
Oh, people don't like Kobe, man. You know this.
But I'm saying, like, other players who have done things to fans, they've been fined. Joakim Noah, they've been fined heavy. I mean, the whole thing, I know it's kind of extreme, but the Malice at the Palace, like, those guys, even guys who didn't take swings, were fined and suspended for games because of that. And we had this fan who literally walked on the court. Like, they were literally on the court because, yes, they were sitting on the baseline courtside, but he got up and, like, walked a few steps onto the floor and, like, gave Westbrook the double middle fingers, told him F you. And so the caller to Stephen A. Smith was like, "Oh, I'm ashamed of Westbrook for making a big deal of it." And Stephen A. was like, "What if it was the other way around? Like, and let's be real, this is an old man that probably has, like, grandchildren doing this. And so we're going to hold the younger guy, Westbrook, to a higher standard than this older gentleman that's supposed to know a lot more." That was crazy.
I mean, also, that guy didn't have money on the line. Just saying.
I mean,
I'm only throwing that out there. He doesn't have money on the line. And Westbrook, being a smart individual, understanding his money situation, to understand that no money, his money won't be affected. But, you know, at the end of the day, he was a stand-up guy. Westbrook, good job, man. Because at the end of the day, that could have been played over and over and over again on ESPN and everybody's news channel. Remember the Palace?
Yeah.
That right there showed that showed like the worst of human nature in general.
Uh-huh.
But they also the media showed themselves in their worst nature too. It's like, oh, this embarrassed the NBA just a tad bit, mm-hmm. and the players, by showing this over and over and over again.
You got that video yet, Mike? All right, so let's show the top 10 plays of the week so far in the NBA. And the Wizards so far, they're trash so far. So far.
Yeah.
Bradley Beal, I know it's two games in, man, but I'm already kind of like, yo, this dude just got 80 mil. like, oh my goodness. The first
Come
two
on,
games.
Brooks. This is your two. These are your
and the Wizards last night were winning by 3 points with like seconds in the game. The game ended up tied, and then Wizards end up losing. So the Wizards are 0-2 right now. Historically, the Wizards, they just can't win close games. I don't know what it is, man. Like, it doesn't matter what year it is. If the game is close, they're going to, wow. Aaron Gordon, my goodness, look at that dunk. They're, you know, if they are in a close game, I am saying the Wizards are going to lose. How many times have you seen a Wizards win a close game?
Since when?
Since forever. Most of the time we lose.
I mean, I've seen one since the Gilbert Arenas and Hughes.
Every team in the NBA has buzzer beaters, but the Wizards typically, when they are in a crunch time situation, they don't win.
They can't do it.
I mean, more times they lose.
It's not the team.
So what is it?
Okay, it's the team. It's the team. I don't know. Like, maybe it's I don't know.
I think it's the culture, man. It's just like we don't have killers out there. Outside of John Wall.
I mean, John Wall is like, he's starting to give me that LeBron killer type thing going. Lately, anyway.
I mean, outside of John Wall, we don't have killers on this team. Outside of Gilbert when he was here. Like, we don't have guys where it's like, give me the ball.
That was a killer.
I'm about to just come out. Ooh, by the way, that's the same Simmons who was already in the top, was already at number what? Number 6 or 7? Or I don't know what number this one is. But he was already in the countdown earlier, by the way. Can't go back, like Bomani Jones said. You can't go back to what he was doing before. So he was already earlier. This is number 5. That was number 6. This is number 5 right here. LeBron James freight train. Look at that. Look at that. By the way, the Knicks, they kind of got demolished game 1, but they didn't look like horrible. I mean, they're going up against a team that's a lot better than them, but they didn't look horrible. Was Simmons. Look at this. Simmons right here. Mind you, the game is over. Look what he had to do.
Oh.
Rest in peace, JaVale McGee. Rest in peace. Oh, my goodness. By the way, JaVale McGee probably needs a little more playing time with the Warriors because I know it's 2 games. They've only played 2 or 3 games so far.
So this is the guy that's trying to feed his kids, right, Simmons?
Simmons, yeah. Trying to feed them kids.
I'm going to let you know, Simmons going to be feeding some kids. He's going to be feeding a lot of kids.
He ain't going to have just a 4-day contract.
No, that 4-day contract is gone.
I mean, a 10-day contract. He's going to be on this roster. And the Spurs somehow always find these people.
He's going to probably get a year.
Spurs haven't had, like, a high draft pick in a long time. Because they're always good. And they had, outside of Kawhi Leonard, they haven't had, like, a first-round draft pick that has actually done something.
Because
everyone that has done something has been undrafted, drafted in the second round, or
picked up off the street.
You know, signed from some league in another country.
Or picked up off the street.
Like or that, too. Yeah, like the Simmons guy, I mean, playing in the D League is pretty much off the street.
The street, yes.
Let's be real here.
You're making like $40,000 a year, possibly.
DeMar DeRozan, look at this. Oh, my God.
This is crazy.
My goodness. My goodness.
Yeah.
What? Oh, my goodness. Number one. Oh, I heard about this. I didn't see it yet, so this is going to be a treat. Oh, no, that's not what I heard about. I think I heard about someone else. I think I heard about this. I thought it was better. I guess because it was the game winner. It was a big deal.
It's just a lucky bounce.
No. Henson got it and put it back in. Like, homeboy missed it. Jabari Parker missed it. But I thought he dunked it the way people made it seem. Man, I guess that's number one, man. So top play so far in the NBA. Let's go right to the NFL. Just play the NBA. NFL. I guess you got to go to the NFL page now and do the same thing because we're having issues right now with my computer. I'm going to go through these scores real quick, starting with Thursday night. Titans beat the Jaguars, which the NFL needs to get rid of these Thursday night games so early in the season. I don't mind the Thursday night games. I think this is what the NFL needs to do. They need to have these Thursday night games start like later in the year, and they need to be with teams that are coming off of bye weeks. That's what it needs to be. Make the schedule in a way where you have these teams have these bye weeks, and then they come and play Thursday night. So instead of 14 days between games, you get 11 days. And that's still enough time to rest, and that's still enough time to have good caliber football, because that's the issue. These Thursday night games, the players are not ready to play Thursday. Any NFL player will tell you this, and I remember asking this to one NFL player that I met, and he just said, look, man, we're just getting back to it on practice on Thursday. Like, we're just putting the pads back on and having practice on Thursday. He's like, now you're asking us to have a game on Thursday. Obviously, we can't put too much into the game plan. Obviously, we're not there all physically, and that's why the games are horrible on Thursday night.
I don't like the games for two reasons. And one of the reasons is that not everyone can view those games. It's only one game. One football game. It's like the only football game playing. And then, like, you're right. It's confusing for players, and it's also confusing for their makeup to actually say, hey, let me go ahead and play a Thursday night game. Oh, snap. Oh, is it Friday? Oh, that's Saturday. Now, Sunday, I got to play again? Are you serious?
But they don't play the Sunday.
They don't play that Sunday. Yeah, but
no,
like,
But they have to come from that Sunday, and then they play Thursday.
Yeah, for coming from like, a Sunday bad. to that Thursday, that's a short week. What if you got a Monday night game?
I could understand the Thanksgiving because that has become such a tradition.
It's a special time.
And not only that, both organizations, the Detroit Lions and the Dallas Cowboys, have already just said, hey, we're going to take this. Like, they're in on it. They're like, look, this is our time. They actually have their contractually obligated actually to play those games if you know your history. But if you play for those teams, you know you're playing on Thanksgiving. And that's fine. It's one time in the year. But now you're having – and it's later in the year. It's in November. You have Thursday night games starting week two. So a team, they'll play their first game. And you know the first game, usually you're – gassed because it's the first game playing an entire game. And then you have to play Thursday night. And the caliber is horrible. And then the thing is, because of these, I guess, Thursday night games, now they're trying to put teams who would normally not be on primetime, and it's showing why they should not be on primetime. Like the Jaguars and the Titans.
That should not be
any night game. Never. And I know they're trying to have at least every team to have one primetime game, but you got to get to a certain level of
winning records. That's how we do it. Are we just do winning records for the next following season?
It's just bad. I understand. Look, even in the horrible years that the Cowboys have, they're going to be on primetime because they're the Cowboys. The Steelers can literally go 0-16 one year. They will still be on primetime because they're the Steelers. They're one of the best franchises when it comes to fan bases. The Raiders, all like the historical one, even the Redskins, they're going to be on prime time. The Redskins, the Patriots, the Packers, the Bears, no matter what their record is, they're going to be on prime time. The Giants. But when your teams like the Titans and the Jaguars and the Buccaneers and the Rams,
the Buccaneers not even playing in Florida right now.
Like when you're these teams, you don't need to be on primetime. So anyway, Jaguars, they were horrible. Blake Bortles still put up some hella numbers for fantasy, but they're horrible. Moving on to your team, Mike, your Washington football team went to England to play the Bengals and ended up in a tie.
I like the fact that we played in London, but I kind of disagree with us playing in London. Because I wonder, what is it for?
I mean, to grow the game, but...
We had the NFL with its own version of the league in London for a while.
I mean, I don't have enough time to get into that, but we will probably talk about that next week. But the game ended in a tie. Redskins kicker Dustin Hopkins had a chance to win the game. Missed the kick. Then Andy Dalton fumbled. Oh, my gosh. I'm seeing Boom's Halloween costume. That is a – oh, wow. So that was distracting. New York in the house, though. then Andy Dalton fumbles the ball. Time expires, ends in a tie. You still have Jay Gruden, who said up to last week he didn't know a game could end in a tie, and he's a head coach of an NFL team.
Of us didn't know a game can end in a tie until last week.
I don't know what kind of football you have been watching.
I know that, but like, it's like pointless to have a freaking tie in the NFL.
I mean, it's kind of dangerous to play a second overtime. Like, dudes will really get hurt. Like,
but like, we gotta find some other way. Like, maybe put like three players.
No, play better.
True.
That's all it is.
True.
Like the Rams, I mean the Seahawks and the Cardinals play better. Y'all put up 6 points.
Yeah, horrible. Yeah, that wasn't like, that great. Yeah.
And then you had kickers missing field goals. Like just play better. That's all you gotta do.
Nah, I think we could look, if it's gonna come down to the kickers at any time at any point, why don't we put it on them?
Play the quarter. And if the game just end the game, man. Just end the game. The rule is the rule. This is one of the rules where I'm like, the rule is the rule, and just play. How much time we got for the entire show? Right, I want to go
3 minutes.
3 minutes. All right, so let me just go through these scores real quick, and then I got what I got to say. Chiefs beat the Colts 30-14. Panthers get their second victory of the season against the Cardinals, 30-20. Raiders, Derek Carr with 500 plus passing yards, broke a record for the franchise record for the Raiders. They won 30-24 against the Buccaneers. Saints beat the Seahawks 25-20. Texans beat the Lions 20-13. Patriots get payback against the Bills 41-25. The Jets almost did what the Jets do. They almost lost to the Browns. But they won 31-28. Broncos got revenge against the Chargers 27-19. Packers, I mean, they ain't looking too good. Even though they scored 32 points, they ain't looking too good. And the Falcons, I mean, every year I'm kind of saying they're going to somehow lose this. Boom is shaking his head because he's seeing Dez Bryant with that phenomenal catch. Falcons win 33-32 against the Packers, and the Cowboys come back to tie the game, and then in overtime beat the Eagles 29-23. Real quick, what I wanted to talk about. Report study came out from Rutgers University, and Boom, I want you to stay for this one. You were on last week, and Two minutes, and want to get to this real quick. Study came out from Rutgers that polled 871 adults, and the question was why are the NFL ratings down? And the number one reason for why the ratings were down, according to this Rutgers University study, was the national anthem protesting.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. Well, yeah. Well, then, man, ain't no justice if we ain't all just. That's probably not an expression, but you know what I'm saying.
I know what you're saying. But I think, okay, I personally think the study is false. Like, that cannot be the reason why ratings are down. Like, I understand the NFL.
I find it bullshit. Say the other thing. It's because of police violence it's down. Fuck a football game if there's police violence. Fuck that shit.
I think the study is false. I think
it's false too.
I think the gameplay is the number one reason why the ratings are down. The
gameplay sucks.
Because these primetime games have all been, think about every primetime game from week one to now.
Whack.
They've literally been one or two
whack
that have been good. And one of them was last night.
Whack. England. You want me to watch my team in England?
At 9:30 in the morning.
At 9:30 in the morning? Come on. please.
Also, I think the referees are horrible.
Horrible.
They make terrible decisions.
Terrible.
But I think gameplay is number one.
Yeah.
If my opinion is, if you're someone, like if you said to me, you're not watching it because of Colin Kaepernick or whoever other player is protesting the national anthem.
I disagree. Kaepernick's actually bringing attention to the game.
True. But I'm just saying, if you were one of those people, I would say you're not a football fan.
Right. Like, dude, you're not watching because of Kaepernick? Like, what are you talking? That doesn't even fucking make sense.
Also, I think another bigger social issue is a lot of this domestic violence.
Yeah,
are going on.
Exactly. Like now you're losing all the women who used to watch football.
Ezekiel Elliott.
Exactly.
And we had the
brand is hurt. Hurt the brand.
So I think those are a lot bigger issues, in my opinion.
Yes.
Than, hey, this guy doesn't like the national anthem. Yeah. Or he doesn't like what the national anthem stands for.
Yeah. And Beckham's a bitch, man. Stop being a bitch, Beckham. Come on, man. Just catch the ball.
Hey, man, it was a bye week for you, man.
But I'm just saying in general, you know what I'm saying? All those antics, that's ridiculous. You know what I mean? Win some games.
We did talk about that last week.
I
just think it's kind of ridiculous. But maybe it may be true, and maybe the NFL has a lot of just casual fans. And maybe when these issues came up,
it's not that important. Right?
Yeah.
Actually,
that may be the only way it's
most
true.
Plausible. Because it's like, if that's what it takes for like sales and interest to go down, how serious could these people be?
And also, it did mention the presidential race. A lot of these primetime games were going up against debates.
Yeah.
Just the race.
Well, Trump's ruining everything. So if the revenue's down, it's because of Trump. Trump, you fucking suck, man.
Oh man, but yeah, I that's the only plausible way.
I agree
that is true.
It's true
that the NFL must have so many casual fans.
Y'all don't really care
that this is the issue.
All right, we gotta wrap up. All
right, man, I want to thank everyone for watching and listening. I want to thank you, Boom, for coming on.
You're welcome.
Shout out to Patrick Ewing and the Knicks and all New York that you got right there. Thank you, Mike, for everything you do. And until next time, everyone, sports reality. Peace.